Equations of Lines and Planes, Level 5. In this video, we're going to learn how to write the equation of a plane. In the first series of videos, titled Three-Dimensional Coordinate Systems, we saw and graphed a couple of equations of planes. However, none of those equations had three variables in them, and were extensions of graphs that we will look at in two dimensions. In this video, we're going to develop a more general equation for describing planes. Although a line in space is determined by a point and a direction, a plane in space is more difficult to describe. A single vector is not enough to convey the direction of a plane. A plane in three-dimensional space is uniquely determined by one of the following three combinations. The first way is by knowing three non-collinear points on the plane. Recall back in your geometry class that this was the way you were introduced to planes. So a plane can be denoted by three non-collinear points. It is important that these three points are non-collinear in order to describe a plane. Otherwise, the three points represent a line or line segment. The second way to determine a plane in space is by knowing a point and two non-parallel vectors on the plane. The third way to determine a plane in space is by knowing a point on the plane and a normal vector to the plane. This third way is by far the easiest and most common way to write the equation of a plane. In practice, we use the second and third combination to determine the equation of a plane. If we are given three non-collinear points, then we transform the problem to the second or third combination and try to deal with the consequences. Since the third combination is way more practical in multivariable calculus, we will start with this combination first. Consider a plane located in a three-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system. Let P0 with coordinates x0, y0, and z0 be a point on the plane. Suppose that we also have a non-zero vector that is orthogonal or perpendicular to the plane. Let's denote this vector as vector n, with components equal to a, b, c. This vector is called the normal vector of the plane. Now let's assume that we choose a random point on the plane. Let's denote it as point P, with coordinates equal to x, y, z. Both point P0 and point P can be represented by position vectors, so we will denote these position vectors as vector R0 and vector R respectively. Let's also label the vector with initial point P0 and terminal point P as vector A. Notice that vector R0 plus vector A is equal to vector R after applying the triangle law for vector addition. Now let's solve for vector A. Doing that, we obtain vector R minus vector R0. Notice that vector A lies completely on the plane. Also notice that the normal vector is drawn on the plane. But similar to the direction vector for lines, it does not have to be touching the plane, and can be located anywhere on a three-dimensional coordinate system. The only requirement is that the vector is normal to the plane. Now, because vector n is orthogonal to the plane, it is also orthogonal to any vector that lies on the plane. In particular, it is orthogonal to vector A. Recall from the dot product video series that two orthogonal vectors will have a dot product equal to zero. So we can write the following vector expression. The dot product of vector n and vector A is equal to zero. We can then replace vector A with vector R minus vector R0, obtaining the following expression. We can then rewrite this expression into an alternative form by distributing vector n and moving vector n dot vector R0 to the other side of the equal sign. Doing that, we obtain the following. These expressions are referred to as the vector equation of a plane. One way to visualize this vector equation is to imagine a pair of orthogonal vectors that share an initial point, and then visualize grabbing one of the vectors and twisting it. As you twist, the other vector spins around and sweeps out a plane. So every plane can be described by a vector on the plane and a vector perpendicular to it. Just like the vector equation of a line in space can be written in various alternative forms, we can also rewrite the vector equation of a plane in space in various alternative forms. Starting with the vector equation of a plane, let's rewrite each vector in component form. We then subtract vector r and vector r0 component-wise. Next, we compute the dot product by using the algebraic definition. Doing that, we obtain the following. This form is referred to as the scalar equation of a plane, and is said to be in standard form. We can rewrite this equation by distributing the constants a, b, and c, and regrouping terms. Doing that, we obtain the following expression. Here, we can replace the negative expression in parentheses with the constant d, since this expression is nothing more than a constant when simplified. Doing that, we obtain a much cleaner form. This expression is referred to as the general form of the equation of a plane in space. This general form might seem familiar to you, since it is often introduced in an intermediate algebra or pre-calculus course when introducing the equation of a plane in 3D space. This form is a linear algebraic equation in x, y, and z. You might also see this equation with the constant d on the right side of the equation. In the end, it describes the equation of a plane in 3D space. This is very similar to the general form or normal form of the equation of a line in R². The general form also represents a family of parallel planes, where each plane has the same equivalent normal vector with components A, B, and C. What makes this form so useful is that we can instantly determine the components of a normal vector for the plane. These components are nothing more than the coefficients of the variables x, y, and z. In this case, one possible normal vector is the vector with components a, b, c. We can also choose any non-zero scalar multiple of this normal vector to describe the plane. In this case, the resulting scalar equation of the plane will also be multiplied by the scalar multiple. For example, the following two equations define the same plane. The first equation uses the normal vector with components 1, 1, 1, and the second uses the normal vector with components 4, 4, 4. So keep in mind that the vector and scalar equation of a plane are not unique. Okay, now you might be asking yourself if we can use parametric equations to define a plane, and the answer to that question is yes. Is it worthwhile to learn it in multivariable calculus? Well, the easiest answer to that question is that the vector equation and scalar equation of a plane are way more convenient when it comes to solving problems in multivariable calculus, especially for planes. But if your class will not cover the parametric form of the equation of a plane, then you may skip this part of the video and move along to the next video. If you're curious and want to learn it, then stick around. Similar to the way we derive the parametric equations of a line in space, we can also derive parametric equations of a plane in space. Notice that the vector equation of a line in space has one parameter, in this case, t. Recall that this parameter played the role of a scalar, which was used to scale the direction vector of the line relative to an initial point. We then took this vector equation and rewrote it in component form. We then separated the vectors component-wise to generate the parametric equations of the line in space. In order to obtain a vector equation of a plane, we're going to need more than a single vector, since a scalar multiple of one vector relative to an initial point will only generate points that are collinear. We need to be able to generate points that are not all collinear. So we solve that problem by using a second vector that is non-parallel to the first vector and starts at the same initial point as the first vector. Let's label each of these vectors as vector A and vector B respectively. Now, we also need to be able to scale the second vector relative to the initial point, so we need an additional parameter to scale the second vector. Let's use the parameter u for vector A and use the parameter v for vector b. Notice that we can generate various combinations of these two vectors by selecting particular values of the parameters u and v. As long as vector A and vector B start at the same initial point and are non-parallel, we can find a vector sum of these two vectors that will generate any point on the plane. In this sense, we say that the linear combination of these two vectors span the plane. Now that we have a vector equation of a plane in space, we can now rewrite it in component form as follows. From here, it is just a matter of separating the vectors component-wise to generate the parametric equations. Notice that each parametric equation of a plane is a function in two parameters, in this case, u and v, while each parametric equation of a line is a function in one parameter, in this case, t. In this sense, a line has one dimension, and a plane has two dimensions. Alright, these are the parametric equations of a plane in space. Once again, these are rarely used to solve problems in multivariable calculus, but the concept of parametric equations with two parameters will be revisited in greater detail in a much later video. For now, you just got a sneak peek of what's to come. Alright, in our next video, we will compare the equations of lines and planes and go over some basic examples that involve the equation of a plane in space.